Well, joining us on Houston Sports Talk is the Texans beat writer for CSN Houston, James Palmer. And let me tell you, there are a small handful of media at every single Texans practice, and James is there more often than many of the Texans players. And so it's great to have you on the show, James. Thanks for joining us. And I'd love to get a couple of things that jump out at you so far after 9 days of camp. I know Sunday the big takeaway was Ryan Fitzpatrick Beard is not hot, and Andre didn't watch the CMTs or the Emmys.
Yeah, exactly. I know you brought up Andre. We had a really good time with Gary Owen, the comedian, working for us for CSN for the day on Sunday, talking to Cushing and asking Cushing about his injured elbow. And Cushing told him he doesn't need Tommy John surgery, which is good. Gary had a good time. He's got a great relationship with Dre. They've been friends for a long time, so it was nice to see him being able to go out there and goof around a little bit with a bunch of the players. But, yeah, after the first 9 days, I think a couple of things you take away is Jadeveon Clowney is as good as advertised, and he's still not 100% yet. You've seen a couple of plays that he's made getting through the line. You've seen him on YouTube because a lot of the practices were not allowed to shoot video. But when he got through the line to Dennis Johnson and could have absolutely destroyed him in the backfield, you saw the explosion and timing he has to count the snap and get through the line. He blocked a Shane Leckler punt after just getting past a line of scrimmage on just about three steps. He's been all over the field, and he's not even 100%. So I think that's been a positive, even though he sat out the last couple of days. Looked like he might have re-aggravated that sports hernia groin area a little bit, but I've been told that it's nothing really to be serious. They're just trying to monitor him as much as possible. And the other thing that really sticks out to me the most, we'll start on the offensive side of the ball, is the quarterback position. Ryan Fitzpatrick is head and shoulders above and better than the other two quarterbacks that are in camp right now. In my personal opinion, Case Keenum is not looking as good in camp this year as he did actually last year. And when you got a guy like Tom Savage that hasn't played very much football in the last three seasons with all the transferring that he did before he played his last year at Pitt and had a lot of success actually the second half of the season, his head's spinning a little bit. You know, I talked to Bill about him today, and he said, you know, it's going to be a whirlwind for him on Saturday when he gets in the game. The amount of things will be thrown at him. But Tom looked really, really good actually in some red zone this morning, hitting Travis Labar for a touchdown. Also, Dennis Johnson around the corner, both on the timing patterns that he was able to throw. And on the defensive side of the ball, I'd really like to see Kareem Jackson and DJ Swearinger moving all over the field. Kareem's been lining up in that slot corner position, which might revolutionize the game and the way slot corners are paid, with him coming up as a free agent after this season. He's really loved that physical role line up inside. And DJ Swearinger, there's been a lot of times he's lining up almost at the line of scrimmage as a linebacker, and they have two safeties lining up behind him. He's got three picks already. Remember, this team had just seven picks in all last year. So there's definitely been some bright spots. There are those guys that aren't playing, like Arian and Andre, that, you know, I have a feeling they're not being rushed back for a lot of reasons, and age and reps have probably a big part to do with that.
One of the guys you talk about is DeAndre Hopkins, who's been a highlight reel. He was last year. What do you think about Hopkins? Do you think the offseason and working with Bill O'Brien's staff, I've heard there's talk that, you know, he's better at his route running and stuff like that. You know, where is he at right now?
Yeah, you know, I got to evaluate Hopkins last year really, really well, because one of our analysts for the network was Keenan McCardle, who's played a ton of football at the wide receiver position, and he talked with me a lot about where, because I know a lot of people weren't seeing it other than, you know, exact football experts that had played the games, or where he was having some issues with his route running. Now you see a guy in camp that just catches everything. There's a lot of back shoulder throws to him from Ryan Fitzpatrick, which is something you didn't see the Texans do in the past. He's been catching balls all over the field. His catch radius is absolutely enormous. I just think if he was a little bit faster, and I mean, he's adequate speed-wise at the wide receiver position, but if he was faster, he has a chance to be really something special in the NFL. Not to say that could hold him back. He had an off season unlike the previous one. I got to talk with him about it the other day, where he was talking about, you know, you got the combine and everything going on in that first year heading into the league. This year he got to do it for himself. Went back to Clemson and worked out with a lot of guys that he wants. He got to do things on his own schedule. And he's one of those guys that is very particular about how he works. He called Andre Johnson repeatedly this offseason. Even when Dre was holding out, he just kept bugging him, you know, when are we working out? When are we working out? They spent morning, noon, and night together last year. He's a guy that wants to get better, and it's shown the work ethic this offseason, because I didn't mention him at first, but he has been unbelievable in camp so far.
I want to ask about the running back situation, keeping on the offensive side of the ball. And Arian Foster is coming back after an injury-plagued season. Of course, the Texans drafted in the sixth round Alfred Blue. What's been your observations as far as the running backs in camp?
Yeah, everybody kind of thought, you know, with Arian now, it was going to be Andre Brown getting most of the reps out of the backfield. And it's been quite the opposite. Alfred Blue has jumped into that second spot, and he has been really running with it, literally and figuratively, with playing that spot and getting the rest with the first team with Arian out right now. He's a three down back, according to Bill O'Brien. I asked him that the other day if he thinks he can play three downs, and he definitely thinks Blue can. You know, he had that ACL tear his sophomore year at LSU, and you remember over the last couple of years, they've had just such a stable of running backs down in Baton Rouge that, you know, he didn't have a lot of tread on the tires from college, but at the same time, it was effective. I mean, the year he went down, I think he was averaging about over five yards a carry before he went down with that ACL. And that's a couple of years away from that. But he can catch the football well. I saw the other day him pick up a safety blitz just brilliantly. So if he can pick up what he has to do when the football's not in his hands, he's going to be fine. They're going to find ways to have him on the field during a large chunks of this season, and definitely during the earlier parts when you're not going to see all of Marion Foster during this preseason.
Do you think Xavier Suafilo will have to start game one at left guard and Ben Jones at right guard because of Brandon Brooks apparently being hobbled?
Yeah, it's been definitely cause for concern. I asked about Brandon today with Bill, and, you know, he said, you know, with all the time that he's missed, he's definitely, you know, coming back. But with all the time he's missed, he's definitely not in football shape. And he said that's a big concern. I think they wanted Suafilo to start at left guard when they drafted him, with a healthy Brandon Brooks on one side, who, in my opinion, played at Pro Bowl caliber football last year. They wanted Xavier to come in and play that left guard spot that was vacated by Wade Smith, who actually just got picked up by the Seahawks for the last couple minutes. They wanted him there week one. He's been playing all over the place. I know today he lined up at three different spots. It was a closed practice, so I can't tell you everywhere he lined up, but count the places he's played. He's played a lot of tackle in college. It was almost 50-50 between tackle and guard when he was at UCLA. I think he's going to get a lot of snaps early on. I think he's going to be probably a starter early on. They have Cupper there right now. I think he's going to pass Cupper as preseason goes on. Remember, he's a little bit behind because he missed a lot of OTAs due to UCLA being on the quarter system. So he was a little bit behind. He's a really, really smart guy. He's an Eagle Scout. I don't know if that matters, but he's a really, really smart kid, and I think he's picking it up quickly.
And as far as Case Keenum goes, I mean, you hate to make too much out of training camp, but yeah, apparently he hasn't looked good. Do you think it's just a mental issue and maybe he can shake it out by the time preseason gets underway? Or is this something more serious? And what does this mean for the number two position?
The number two position is definitely up for grabs. But at the same time, if anything happens to Ryan Fitzpatrick, if you were a Texans fan, I don't think you would want to see either one of those guys out there, Case Keenum or Tom Savage, running this offense right now. Now, that doesn't mean either one can't get better by the time the season starts. And it also doesn't mean that the Texans can't make a move for a quarterback at any point to be Ryan Fitzpatrick's backup or compete for that backup role. They're not locked into everything. Obviously, Tom is more locked in than to say Case is, because he was a draft pick and he's somebody that really fits Bill O'Brien's mold. And if you look at everything that Tom Savage is about, it just screams Bill O'Brien quarterback, and I think he's got the most talent on this team by far. Case is the only holdover at the quarterback position. The other two were brought in specifically by Bill O'Brien. So if I was Case, I mean, you know, obviously I'm not, but he hasn't had the best of camps, and I think a lot of it's mental, and a lot of it, you know, has been physical as well, where balls have been sailing on him and stuff. So he's got a lot to prove. I mean, absolutely a ton to prove over these next couple preseason games, because Tom's not going to – Ryan Fitzpatrick's not going to play a ton during these early preseason games, hardly at all.
Well, if there's one thing we've learned this week, James, Arian Foster, he's trying to be a good teammate and work hard. just so our listeners know, those are a couple of this administration's mantras. Obviously, we've gotten the Belichick lockdown on good sound bites this year. I'm just wondering, from your perspective, what do you think of all that? How do you deal with that as a reporter?
Well, I think you have to make yourself as educated as possible as a reporter. Bill's not going to hand you anything, and I kind of respect that. You know, and that's starting to be the case with a lot of the members of this organization, and that includes the players. I mean, you got to come with good questions. You have to have a reason why you're asking that question, and he's not just going to throw, you know, answers out to you. And like I said, I respect that. I think a lot of the players have gotten pretty cliche-driven, but there's still guys that you can go to. I talked to DJ Swearinger for about 20 minutes today, and that guy's telling me about his end zone dances and how he trash talks and how he's going to clean up his trash talk with the new rules within the NFL and how he can get in different guys' heads. These rookies, you could tell that Bill O'Brien got to them early on, and they're not going to tell you a whole lot, but there's certain veterans that it's part of their personality, and now it's almost like there's a couple of guys that have to be more of your go-tos, like, you know, Dwayne Brown, Andre. Those guys will tell you what they think. They'll also speak within the rules of what Bill O'Brien wants things to do, but you can't get upset with the way a guy wants to run his organization, and, you know, it's a privilege to cover the team. It's a great job to cover the NFL in general, and you know, I'm not going to sit there and complain about what happens and what doesn't happen. I can't eat at the cafeteria anymore. That part kind of stinks. But outside of that, you know, it's his ship. We're all just kind of watching him do it. But he's a really, really smart guy. He's a guy that's come in and brought a different attitude into this team. And Andre Johnson noticed it within a couple hours, what the feeling was around this organization with Bill O'Brien. I think, frankly, after what happened last year, it was definitely needed.
Which players do you like talking to? You mentioned a couple of guys. I've noticed Mike Thomas. He's pretty fun to talk to. Justin Tuggle, he's a great soundbite. And if his ability is anything like, you know, his ability to talk and his presence and everything, you know, I'm hoping he develops a little bit into that.
Yeah, Justin's a great soundbite. He's a really smart guy. He's a really smart kid. He speaks very, very well. And, you know, he has an advantage at that linebacker spot with the history of him playing quarterback. I talked to him about it earlier this week. Just, you know, when you line up at that middle linebacker spot and you're staring at a quarterback, you know what that quarterback's thinking because you played at the college level more than pretty much everybody else on the defensive side of the ball. He's playing really, really well. Mike Muhammad's also receiving a lot of praise from Romeo Crennel's side of the ball in that middle linebacker spot. But, yeah, some of the guys, Swearinger's always a great guy to talk to. Dwayne's a great guy to talk to. You know, Dre's always, he'll always listen to your question and talk to you. Some people think Brooks Reed doesn't really bring it for them, but I totally disagree and think he really listens to your question, really listens to what you have to say and tries to answer it in the best of his ability. Listen, some of these guys, their personality is the way it is one way or the other, but when you're a rookie and you're brought in your first NFL camp, obviously you're going to close your mouth a little bit more than some of the veteran guys.
As far as Fitzpatrick goes, you know, they say he's smart, he's throwing accurately. Do you think that this could possibly be his best season yet since he's seasoned and supposedly we hear O'Brien is installing a quarterback-friendly system?
I think I said this once before on another program where I don't think he's going to be Rich Gannon in the second half of his career, but I do think, you know, he's probably an average quarterback or below average quarterback talent-wise in the NFL. And probably most people wouldn't disagree with me on that. But I think Bill's system and the weapons around him make him a better quarterback and a more effective quarterback. The liberties that he's going to have at the line of scrimmage compared to what Matt Schaub had with Gary Kubiak is going to be completely different. There's all sorts of adjustments and audibles that are changed within routes, within coverage, after the ball snap, before the ball snap, in the huddle, you know, at the line of scrimmage. He has a lot of liberties mentally that I think he can succeed at. Now, he has to be able to not force the ball. He's a guy that has almost a 1-to-1 touchdown to interception ratio for his career. If he can make the right decisions and he's accurate with the football, you just look at the number of weapons he has in Hopkins, who we already talked about, Andre Johnson, potentially a future Hall of Famer. You have Mike Thomas in the slot. You know, you have a decent pass-catching tight end and Garrett Graham, and then also C.J. Fedorowicz, who's kind of passed Ryan Griffin, it seems like, lately. Still can do some things. And then Arian Foster, nobody says it, but is really one of the better pass-catching running backs in the entire NFL. So you have guys that he can definitely get the ball to. It's if he makes the right decisions and he's accurate, he doesn't force things, he checks down when he has to check down to Arian in the flat or Alfred Blue in the flat. If he makes those decisions, I think you're right. He could have one of the best seasons he's had in recent memory. And last year, he was great in the red zone. And if he can continue to do that, which he's done well in practice, they're going to put some points on the board. As long as he doesn't turn the ball over, they're going to be fine. He can't fumble the football here. That's a problem he's had.
I just want to ask one quick thing on the defensive side of the ball. With Brian Cushing being out the preseason here, still recovering from his injury from last season, how has Brooks Reed looked on his move to inside linebacker?
Brooks Reed is a really, really good football player, and I think he doesn't get very much credit for it. A lot of people said, well, he's moving inside and then he's moving outside. It doesn't make him, you know, they don't know where to put him because he's not that good. I'm like, it's because he's more versatile is why he stays on the field as much as he does. I think you're going to be able to see him possibly sometimes inside and outside in the same series, on the same drive. He's going to move back and forth. I think you're going to see him outside in the end game a lot more than you see him inside. It's nice to have him getting some reps. It's nice for guys like Muhammad and Tuggle and Max Buller, who's an undrafted rookie, getting the chance to make a lot of calls in the middle of the field. But a lot of the times, they're just only going to have one middle linebacker on the field anyways, and then B.J. Swearinger is going to be lining up virtually as that other middle linebacker. So you really aren't going to see, I don't think, Brooks inside a whole ton unless they're playing two middle linebackers and they're not in dime and they're not in nickel in one of those situations. So he looks good inside. He looks good outside. It's because he's a talented football player. So he sets the run better than most of their outside guys do by sealing that corner and that edge. But you'll see him outside more than inside. So it's nice to see that he can play both, but I think we're going to see him outside more.
Well, great stuff from CSN Houston's James Palmer. Follow him on Twitter, at JPalmerCSN. Pleasure to have you with us, James. I'll see you out on the grind.
Sounds good, guys. Thanks for having me.
You can listen to more of our interviews and podcast on HoustonSportsTalk.net. Subscribe to Houston Sports Talk for free on iTunes or on the Stitcher app.